Thank you very much. And before I begin, I would like to thank John and Courtney for giving me the opportunity both to speak here and also to meet with all of you. I'm looking forward to meeting and talking with all of you about functional programming, especially Haskell. I'm a huge Haskell fanboy, as some of you know. And also I'd like to thank everybody who helped get us safe and sound here through BusConf, especially Courtney. She did an amazing job making sure that we got here today. And so today, I'm going to be talking about applied category theory in abstract algebra. And I know probably a lot of people in this room don't really know category theory. And the purpose of this talk is to not assume that you know category theory, and not even to actually teach you category theory, but rather just to get you excited about it by showing like really cool things you can do with it and how it can benefit real-world practical programs. So this is more just to give you a taste of it to get you excited about upcoming talks that Alejandro will be giving on we'll be going more into depth about category theory. And so the way I always like to begin talking about category theory is just to talk about function composition. And in this talk, all the code examples are going to be in Haskell. I won't assume you know Haskell, so I'll try to explain them in as much depth as possible if you don't. And this talk will try to target a wide range of experience levels. So the beginning of the talk will be focused more towards beginning programmers, and the talk will increase in difficulty as we get more to the end for target more advanced and experienced programmers. So first thing I want to begin is, who here is familiar with the mathematical definition of function composition? So yeah, a lot of people, right? And so this right here is not only the definition of function composition, but it's also legal Haskell code, which is really cool. So it says that if you want to compose two functions named f and g using a function composition operator, which we'll denote as a dot, then that will give us a new composite function. And if we apply that composite function to some argument named x, it'll be the same as f applied to g applied to x. And so information flows from inside to out. So first we apply g to x, and then we apply f to the results of that. And so here's an example of a function composition pipeline. So we have a list, and we want to first take the length of the list, and we compose that to get, and then see, is that length even? And we compose that to see, basically reverse the result of even. So now we're going to see if it's odd. So if we chain those three functions to generate a new composite function, and we apply that to the list 1, 2, and 3, we get true, indicating it had an odd length. Haskell actually already has an odd function, but I just wanted to show more than two things composed at a time. And that is also equivalent to this version, just using explicit parentheses. And function composition pairs well with another function, which we like to call the identity function, or ID for short. And you can read this Haskell code as saying the identity function takes one argument, named x, and it just returns back that argument. It doesn't do anything to it. And, for example, if I apply the identity function to 4, well, it does nothing. I just get back 4. And the reason I say these functions pair well together is that they obey three very useful laws, which we like to call, first, the left identity law, which says that if we compose the identity function with any other function named f, we're going to get back f. So the identity function has no effect under composition. And that's true whether or not we compose it on the left or the right of the composition operator. And the last law says that the function composition operator should be associative, meaning that it doesn't really matter where we put the parentheses, the behavior is going to be exactly the same. In fact, we could just omit the parentheses and the meaning would be totally unambiguous. And that's what we did, for example, in our previous example. We didn't actually specify whether or not we compose non-even first or even at length first, because it's not going to change the meaning of our program. And so the reason I like to begin from function composition is that function composition pipelines resemble Unix pipelines a lot. So I'm sure, how many people here are familiar with the Unix command line, the Unix philosophy to programming? Okay, good, excellent, almost everybody here. If you're not, I'll rehash it, which says that in Unix philosophy, you want to break complex programs down into simple programs, each of which does one thing and does it well. And you compose those simple programs together to build larger and more interesting programs. So, for example, not, length, and even are three, actually, I got it wrong on those. Sorry about that, it should be length less. But, so not, length, and even are all three functions that do one thing and do them well. And then we compose them together to build a more interesting function. Just the same way that on the command line, we would compose, you know, ls function to list the contents of directory, then filter that through grep to get all files named with a foo in their name, and then filter that with the word count function to see how many such files there were.
And so a lot of parallels. So function composition resembles the Unix pipe operator. Functions resemble Unix commands. And each simple program does one thing and does it well.
And so, okay, sorry. So what we would like to do is to take this notion of composability and generalize it to things other than functions and other than Unix command pipelines. We want to find more interesting programming domains where we can still get this nice property of composability so that we can take complex software architectures and break them down into simpler components that do one thing and do it well. So the way I'm going to organize this talk is into three main sections. The first section, I'm going to talk about how we can define lots of different types of composable values that will resemble these sorts of pipelines. And then I'm going to end that with the second section, which will actually take this and flesh it out into a real, large, sophisticated example showing a real-world application of this composability.
And then in the third section, I'm going to show how you can not only compose things at the value level, but you can also compose things at the type level and do really cool things that way.
Sorry, before I continue, are there any questions? No? Okay.
So, in Haskell, provides type classes, which are a form of, which is basically Haskell's version of interfaces with some differences. And the simplest composable interface in Haskell is the monoid type class. And if you're new to Haskell, the way you would read this is you say that some type M, where M is a placeholder for a real Haskell type, can implement this monoid interface if it provides implementations for two methods. First, it has to implement this mempty method, meaning that there must be some default or empty value of type M. And it's called mempty, which is short for monoid empty. And then it has to also implement a binary function called mapend, short for monoid append, which takes two values of type M and combines them to give you back a new value of type M. And then Haskell also provides a convenient diamond bracket infix operator, which is just a convenience operator, which is a synonym for mapend. And the really important thing is that all implementations of the monoid type class have to obey three laws. The first law says that if we combine mempty with any other value, named x, we should get back x. In other words, mempty should be do nothing. And this is very similar to the function composition law, which says that if we compose the identity function with f, we should get back f. Same thing, mempty's identity on the right, which is why we call it also a right identity. And then this operator should be associative, just like function composition is associative. So these three laws are a pattern that shows up over and over and over again in lots of different interfaces and programming domains. And then mathematicians just notice this pattern in math, and we see it in programming too, and they developed an entire area of mathematics just to studying this sort of pattern and how we can make use of it. And the two fields that are very closely related to that are category theory and abstract algebra. So here's an example implementation of this monoid interface. So again, if you're not familiar with Haskell, in Haskell, if you see something in brackets, it means different things depending on whether it's a type or if it's a value. So for example, this is a type. If you see some type A in brackets, that means a list of A's. And A, again, is a placeholder type. In Haskell, if a type begins with a lowercase letter, like this lowercase a, that means it can be any type at all. So we can say a list of any type of value can implement this monoid interface. If you see brackets where you expect a Haskell value, that's a list literal, or a list value. So this right here would be, for example, a list with zero elements. So this implementation says all lists implement the monoid interface, or we can just say all lists are monoids for short, where mempty is an empty list. And if we want to combine two lists together, we just concatenate those two lists. So for example, and this implementation satisfies the monoid laws. So if you concatenate an empty list with x, you get back x. And then the concatenation operator is associative. So here's an example of using the monoid interface. So this right here is a one-element list containing a 7. Here's a one-element list containing 11. If we concatenate them, we get a two-element list containing 7 and 11. And instead of using the specific list concatenation operator, we could instead use this diamond bracket monoid operator to also combine them. It's identical. It's synonymous for concatenation in the context of lists. We could also ask for an empty value. That's a list of integers, and we'll get back an empty list. And then in Haskell, strings are just list of characters. There are better text types in Haskell, but we'll stick with strings for simplicity. So that means that you can combine strings using the same line operator. And so, for example, if I combine string ABC and DEF, I'll get the string ABCDEF. And that's because these strings are just syntactic shorthand for lists of characters. Here's another cute little modeling instance, which says that, so again, Haskell, we're overloading syntax at both the type and the value level. This is what we call the unit type, and this is what we call the unit value. You can think of unit as being like a zero tuple, or a record with no fields. There's only one unit type, and there's only one value that has that type. So we call this the unit type, and we call this the unit value. If you want to be confusing, we'll just call it unit and let you figure out which one we meant. So it says the unit type implements the line interface, or unit is a monoid. If the empty is just the unit value. And if we combine two unit values together where there's only one possible result we can return, which is the unit value again. So this is a very trivial implementation, and mathematicians sometimes call this the trivial monoid. So if I wanted to, for whatever reason, I could map in two units together and I'll get back unit. I can ask for an empty value of type unit and get a unit value back as the result. All right, so my question for the audience is, what is the whole point of even implementing some monoid instances for lists or, say, unit, right? Like, if I want to combine two lists, why not just use list concatenation? What's the point of doing this indirection through the monoid operator? Or if I wanted an empty list, why am I using mempty? Like, why not actually use the empty list literal? It's shorter. What do you think are some reasons why we would want to define this interface? Abstraction?
You can change your implementation. You can go from string to some other type of string.
That's right. You can change the underlying implementation by programming to a specific interface. That's correct.
You can have algorithms on monoids, which apply for all monoids.
That's right. You can write algorithms which are generic over all possible monoids. That's a very good answer, too. Any other? Yes?
Just so you don't have to import too much stuff.
Yeah, to reduce the size of your imports, because you only need to import data.monoid. Yes, that's actually a very good reason too. So, like one person mentioned, we can write functions which are generic over this interface. And one such function is this monoid concat function, or mconcat. So you can read this as saying, mconcat has type, and it's a function. So this type has two halves to it. One is constraints, and then the actual function type. So it says, this function will collapse a list of m's into a single m if and only if m implements the monoid interface. And when we do that is we just keep appending each new element that we find, and if the list is empty, we just return the empty monoid value of type m. And because mconcat works for any type that implements monoid, well, lists and unit implement monoid, so I can concatenate a list of lists, or I can concatenate a list of units. That's not that useful, but I can do it anyway. But what's really cool about Haskell is not only can functions be generic over specific interfaces, but implementations can also be generic over specific interfaces. So for example, I can write this instance. Oh, again, so let me explain Haskell syntax. So the Haskell syntax for a tuple is overloaded at both the type and the value level. So this is the type of a two-tuple in Haskell, where the first field has type A, and the second field has type B. This is a two-tuple value, where the first field's value is empty, and the second field's value is empty. So type, value. And so we read this implementation, we say, so a tuple of two types, A and B, is a monoid if and only if A is a monoid and B is a monoid. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna have an implementation which is going to delegate to another monoid instance. So it says, well, the empty tuple is just a tuple of two empty values. And so if you're new to Haskell, this might seem very confusing. Here we have the word mempty three times in a row. Any time it means something different. So mempty on the left is the empty two-tuple of type A and B. This mempty right here is the mempty for the type A, and this mempty right here is the mempty for the type B. So also in this case, Haskell uses type inference to figure out which mempty we meant in each case. Same thing on this line right here. Three mapins, they each are a different mapin for a different type. So we say if we want to combine two tuples together, we combine them field-wise. So we combine both of their left fields to get the new left field for the tuple. And we combine both of their right fields to get the new right field for the tuple. So for example, we could pick the case where A is a list of integers and B is a list of integers, which implies that a tuple of two lists of integers must be a monoid. And that's why, for example, we can combine two tuples of lists of integers using the same modulate operator. In this case, we just combine this 2 with that 5, then that 3 with that 7 to get this new composite tuple. And similarly, I can ask for the empty value that's it, whose type is a tuple of lists. That'll give me a tuple of 2 empty lists. And MVCAP works on a type that's a monoid, so I can plot in a list of tuples of lists into a single tuple of lists. And this is the part that's actually really cool to me, because I like proving things in Haskell. And not only can we write implementations, which are generic, over an interface, we can write proofs, which are generic, over an interface. So say I wanted to prove one of the monoid laws for our monoid instance for tuples. Well, let's say I want to prove the law that if I combine a tuple with memty, that I should get back the original tuple. The way I can do that is, well, first off, I remember that this operator is a synonym for mapend, and then memty for tuples, so the compiler will infer that this memty has to be for a true tuple. So the compiler will say, okay, so that's equivalent to a tuple of two memtys right here, because that's how we defined it. And then we say, mapend says if we combine two tuples, we combine the respective fields. And the magic is in this last step right here. So what we're going to do is we know that the type A implements the monoid interface. And therefore, the monoid's laws must be true for the type A, including the right identity law. So I can use the right identity law for the type A to just simplify this to XL. And I can do the same thing for the right field right here. I can use the monoid right identity law for the type B to simplify this size of the tuple to get back XR. So I've taken a more complex monoid proof, I've proven it in terms of smaller and simpler monoid proofs. And what's neat about this is that this is true no matter what types A and B are. So for example, what if A and B were tuples themselves? So here's a type. I have a tuple nested inside of a tuple. And so we know that a list of integers is a monoid, or a tuple of two lists of integers is a monoid. So this must be a monoid. And if this is a monoid, and this is a monoid, then the whole thing must be a monoid. And so we can just keep chaining tuples nesting indefinitely. So here I have two really large and deeply nested tuples, which are acting sort of like fixed width lists of integers. And I can just map them together, and the compiler will know to do the right thing. It will chain all those monoid instances for me, and it will know that this 1 goes with this 6, and then this 2 goes with that 7. And so forth. And then that unit will get combined with that unit over there to get this unit right over here. Now here's a real interesting monoid instance. I find it interesting because it's actually recently added in GHC8, and you can do a lot of things with this monoid instance, which are really cool and cute. Maybe a little bit too clever, but I still love it. And I love it because also I was the one who added this instance to GHCA. So if you hate this instance, you can blame me. So again, if you're not familiar with Haskell, you see IO followed by B, that's the type of a subroutine that returns a value of type B. And you can read this as saying, if B is a monoid, then a subroutine that returns a value of type B is also a monoid. So the empty subroutine is the subroutine that does nothing and returns the empty value of type B. And if we want to combine two subroutines together, we run the first subroutine, we store its result as the value, let's call it A. We run the second subroutine, we store its result as the value named B. And then we return A combined with B. And so for example, let's look at some ways that we can use this monoid instance. So Haskell Prelude provides a getLine function, which is a subroutine that will block waiting for a single line of input from standard input, and then it will return whatever line it read. And so, for example, if I run getLine and I type hello, and then hit enter, it will return the string hello. And because string is a monoid, strings are lists, that implies that a subroutine that returns a string is a monoid. So for example, I can then combine getLine with getLine, and so it's still a subroutine that returns a string, and what will happen is if I run this, it will block waiting for two lines of standard input, and then it will combine the two lines that I enter. So if the first line is hello, and the second line is world, then it will respond with hello world. I can do the same thing with a subroutine like print1. So print1 is a subroutine that returns the unit type. And the unit type is sort of like void in Java and C. It's the value we return when we don't have anything to return. And since the unit type is a monoid, then a subroutine that returns a value of the unit type is also a monoid. So that means, for example, I can combine print 1 and print 2 using the monoid operator, and then it will run both of their side effects and combine the results. The results are units, so it just returns unit.
My question.
Yes.
Why would you do this instead of using IO monoid for doing the same thing?
Ah, so the question was, why would you do this instead of using the IO monad? There's a couple reasons. The most important one is that you usually want to nest the IO monad in something else. So we want to create a larger derived monoid instance in terms of the monoid instance for IO. I'm actually going to show an example of that on the next, not the next slide, but the one after that. And then also just because like I think it's kind of elegant that you can actually use the monoid operator to sequence things. I just think that's cool. So if you had trouble following along, here's just a brief equational reasoning example to show like what's going on under the hood when we combine two getLines together. So he said the monoid operator is a synonym for mapend, and then if we mapend two subroutines, that's equivalent to run the first subroutine, store the result, that's a string, run the second subroutine, getLine, store the result, that's a string, and then we return the combined two strings. And since strings are lists, when we combine them, that's just list concatenation. So that's how we know that this is equivalent to run getLine again, and then return the results combined. Same thing for print. If we combine print 1 and print 2, that's the same thing as run print 1, store its result, its result is unit. Run print 2, store its result, the result is unit. And then return unit combined with unit. And we, like we said before, unit combined with unit is just unit. So this is equivalent to just running print 1, running print 2, and returning unit. So actually, here's another answer to your question, which I think is, so you asked why we want a monoid instance for IO. Here's a compelling example of a monoid instance for IO and how we can use it. If you ever written a wizard utility, very often in a wizard, you want to prompt the user for input, so you request some information, and then you respond with some result after you've prompted them for something. So here we want to write a wizard which prompts the user for their name, prompts the user for their age, and then, in this case, does nothing with it, just responds with their name and responds with the age. And we'd like to do so in such a way that all the name logic is in one place, and all the age-related logic is in one place, but we can still combine them together and interleave their side effects. And one way we can do that is we can actually have a subroutine returning a subroutine. What we'll do is we'll have the outer subroutine will be responsible for requesting input from the user. And then the inner subroutine will be responsible for printing output to the user. So for example, this prompt name subroutine will first say, enter your name. It'll read the user's name from standard input. And then it's going to return, it's not going to do anything just yet. It's just going to return a subroutine which contains the instructions for printing the name. And we're going to do the exact same thing for age. The outer subroutine reads input. The inner subroutine writes output. And so what will happen is when we combine these two subroutines together, we will interleave. The two outer subroutines will get combined together into a new outer subroutine. And then the two inner subroutines will get combined together into a new inner subroutine. So all the prompts will get batched together at the beginning of the program, and all the responses will get batched together at the end of the program. And at the end, I just run the two composite subroutines, and then this gives me back this subroutine that I can use to respond to the user, and I just run that. And here's an example of running it at the bottom. It'll say, enter your name, Gabriel, enter your age, 31, and then I'll respond with Gabriel, and your age is 31. And this is a very simple example of the principle we're building towards. We want to have components, each of which does one thing and does it well. This prompt name does one thing, does all the name-related stuff. Prompt age does just one thing, all the age-related stuff, and it's one indivisible package. And then we can just combine them all together using a single operation. If I add new types of prompts, they can all, again, be indivisible units, and I would just mapend them here to just add them as plugins to my program.
Could you go back to your previous slide? Just
what was
the one where you combined with MMT?
Yeah.
The previous slide, could you?
What was your question?
I just wanted to look at it.
Oh, this slide?
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Okay. So, again, well, we could also mconcat our plugins if we wanted to. Here's another useful monoid instance, which is in base, which says that functions are monoids. Specifically, a function from some type A to some type B is a monoid, if and only if the result type B is a monoid. It doesn't matter what type A is. So for example, the empty function is just a function that ignores its input and returns an empty result of type B. And if we want to combine two functions named f and g, we're going to create a new anonymous function which will expect one input named x. We'll apply f and g both to x and then combine the results. So, for example, I can actually use this to combine the putStringLine function with itself. So putStringLine is a function that if you give it a string, it will print that string to standard output. And if I combine it with itself and give it a string argument, then it will print that string twice. And the reason this works is because, well, first off, unit is a monoid. Therefore, a subroutine that returns unit is a monoid. Therefore, a string, a function from a string to a subroutine that returns unit is a monoid. So here's, again, the equational reasoning example. If I combine putStringLine with putStringLine that we create, so these are functions, and when we combine functions, we create a new anonymous function, we call both functions on that argument, then combine the results. The results are a subroutine, so when we combine two subroutines, we run both of them and combine the results, and the two results are unit, so when we combine two units, we get back unit. So we know that this is equivalent to a function that will take a string named x, print that string twice, and then return unit. All right, so this goes through all the simple examples of monoid instances. In the next few slides, I'm going to show a much more complex example. And before I do, I just wanted to see if anybody had any questions.
Why putStringLine, why did the getLine only put one argument?
So the question was, why did putStringLine print the line twice? And when I combine getLines, why is it that when I combine two putstring lines, it prints twice? When I combine two get lines, it only prints once. The reason why is that in putstring line, I am combining their side effects, whereas in the side effect of putstring line is to actually print the string. So that's why you get the side effect twice when you combine them. In get line, the side effect is to read a line. So that's what gets doubled, is the actual reading of the line, as opposed to the returning of the line only happens once because, well, a subroutine can only return one value. You can't return a value twice from a subroutine. Something else? Yes?
What's the difference between composing and combining?
The question is, what's the difference between composing things, like function composition, and combining things, like the monoid combining operator? The answer is, not really that. So there's one key difference, which is that in function composition, you can compose two things and it might not type check, right? You can combine a function with another function and their ends just don't match. There's a type error. Whereas when you combine things in monoids, it'll always type check as long as they're the same type of value. That is probably the biggest difference between the two. Actually in category theory, the way a monoid is a special case of a category where you just have one possible way that you can connect things. That's why all the combination ways you can combine things type check for a monoid. Whereas functions, there are lots of different interfaces that you can combine things, those interfaces being the types. And so that's why when you combine functions, they can sometimes not type check. Yes?
So what that means is that it'll return an error as soon as you write it. It'll return an error as soon as possible.
Yes. So if you try to compose two functions where the types don't match up, it will be a compile time type checking error as opposed to a runtime error. Any other questions? Okay. So now we're going to add a new monoid to our toolbox, which is a monoid which is a wrapper around Haskell support for software transactional memory. So I'm not going to use the full features of transactional memory in this presentation, just two features. One is that transactions can block, meaning that, so transactions can do one of two things. They can either say return a value, which is run as a single transaction, or they can block and say I'm not ready to complete yet. All right, and then you can also try to choose between two alternative transactions. So you can say, try the first transaction. If that returns a value, we're done. Or if it does return a value, if it blocks, try the second transaction. And if that returns a value, we're done. If both of them block, then the whole thing's blocked. So retry is how a transaction can block. And this or else function is how you can combine two transactions, preferring the first one that succeeds. And so we're going to wrap that in a monoid interface, and that satisfies the monoid laws. So retry is empty, or else is an append, and for example, retry is the identity of or else, and the or else infix function is associative. We're going to add one other monoid to our interface, which is a monoid from one of my libraries called the manage library. So this is a library that basically lets you wrap to express typed values that are guarded in some way, resources that you can acquire. So you see a value of type manage A. You can think of that as like a managed resource of type A. There's some setup logic associated with it, maybe. There's, then you acquire a value of type A, then when you're done using it, there's some teardown logic associated with it. And this says that, well, if A is a monoid, then a protected resource of type managed A is also a monoid, where I'm not going to show the implementation, but memt basically acquires an empty resource with no setup and no teardown logic. And if you combine two resources, you combine their setup logic, you get both those resources and you combine them, and then you combine their teardown logic. Okay, so now here's the real world example. So there's a great quote which says something like, an idiomatic Haskell program is 20 lines of imports, 6 language extensions, and then 1 line of Perl. So I hope this ain't true yet in this example. I don't have the 6 extensions, but everything else is pretty much correct. So here's our, I'm gonna skip the imports. This is just to make it real. Okay, it's gonna use real Haskell libraries and do something useful. All right, 1 import for overloaded strings. Here's the transaction monoid I introduced in the previous slide. Here's the, and then the managed type is just imported my own library. And what we're going to do is we're going to define combinable streams of events. So an event can be either a tick, like basically indicating some time has passed. It can be a key press, indicating that the user typed something in standard input. Or it can be a message that, let's say we want to spawn a server to listen for messages and then do something with those messages. So that'll be the third type of event. I'm going to create a plugin for all 3 types of events. And I don't expect you to understand the full code. I'll just give you a high-level overview of what each one does. So chars is the plugin that reads in characters from standard input. And the way it works is that it first creates a transactional queue, and then it forks a thread. The thread is just gonna read things from standard input, stuff it into the queue, and that's the setup logic. So this is a managed thing. So the setup is forking the thread, you know, making sure, and then making sure that if we tear down the thread, it tears down gracefully. And then the thread will, and then when we're done with that, we're gonna return a transaction to read from the queue. And every time we run this transaction, if the queue has a value in it, the transaction will pop a value off the queue and return that, in this case, character. If the queue is empty, the transaction will block, and then we're gonna try the next transaction. And then we're gonna do almost the exact same thing for our ticks plugin. So this is what will record the passage of time. And again, it's gonna fork into a transactional queue, and then create a thread that will write to this queue once a second with a tick event. And then it's going to return a transaction to read from that queue. Again, if there's an element, it'll succeed. And if there's no elements, then the transaction will block. Try the next transaction. And then last thing for messages, we're going to do is we're going to set up a server. So again, this has setup logic associated with it. It has teardown logic associated with it. We're forking threads. And what the server is going to do is going to listen on some local port 8080. And every time we get a thread, it's going to stuff the request body of a thread into the queue and then return a transaction to read a message from that queue. And so here's the promised 1 line of Perl. So if we want to combine all 3 of our events, we just say mapend the character plugin with the ticks plugin and the messages plugin. And this works because, first off, a transaction is a monoid. And therefore, if this is a monoid, then a managed transaction of events is also a monoid, which is why we can combine these event streams together. And at the bottom is the driver logic, which basically does the actual setup and acquisition of our composite event stream, then keeps running the transaction and printing whatever gets off the queue repeatedly. So let's actually show an example of that. So here I'm gonna run, I think it's this one. So this is the actual program. So every second we're getting a tick event. Can everybody see that? Or let me just make it a little bit bigger here. Okay, so every second we're getting a tick event written to the queue. If I type in some characters, I'm gonna see them show up. And then, in a separate terminal, I can just say curl, I should probably just do this so you can see what's happening at the same time. Curl, localhost, 8080, I think it's how you do this data. And there you can see the ASDF message show up in the message queue. And then foo, same thing right there. So, again, one of the nice things about this is because we have everything doing one thing and doing it well, it's very easy for us to add or remove plugins, right? Let's say I just want to turn off the server for my stream. All I have to do is just delete messages from the program. In fact, I'll just do that right now. So example 00, sorry. And then I'm just going to delete messages and then rebuild things. It'll take a few seconds, bear with me, but I want to show that this actually works. All right, and then I'm just going to run the same example. So again, ticks are still working. Standard input characters are still working. But now if I try to send data, the server's not up. It's not listening anymore. So adding or removing plugins is very simple because each plugin does one thing, does it well, is totally self-contained. And then this is like very much in the spirit of the Unix philosophy. And so we can keep extending things in different ways. So let's say I want to make each of these plugins configurable in some way. For example, let's say here's our program configuration that we're going to configure two things. One is how long we delay in between each tick. So far we've been spending 1 second in between ticks, and now we want to make that a configurable thing. Second thing we want, in this case, in milliseconds, or sorry, microseconds. And then we also want to configure the server. So you just want to say, make it so that whenever the server accepts a request, it will respond back with some message, which will be part of the configuration. And then we will modify all three plugins in the exact same way. Each plugin will now take a new argument, which is the configuration that we're going to pass to that plugin. The charge plugin is just going to ignore that configuration. It doesn't use it at all. But for example, our ticks plugin will use that configuration to decide how long it will delay in between each tick. And then our messages plugin will use that same configuration to decide what message is going to respond with whenever we hit the server with a request. And then, again, the only change we make to events is that we just change the type. Now it's just returning a function of a configuration instead of just the original managed transaction. And we can still just map in the plugins together because, again, transaction of events is a monoid. Therefore, managed transaction of events is a monoid. Therefore, a function from a configuration to a managed transaction of events is a monoid. And the only change we make to our driver program is we just pass in the configuration right here, and that gets properly threaded to all three plugins. We can show an example of that working. So let me, run that program. So now we're getting 2 seconds in between each tick. And then if I hit the server with some data, the server thanks me for that data now. And so we can go a step further. We can just keep extending these plugins. You have a question?
How does each plugin know what to pull out of the config?
In this case, I told the plugin. It's in the logic of the plugin itself. So the question was, how does each plugin know what to pull out of the config? In this case, they're all being passed the complete configuration. So if they want to get the relevant information out, they need to access the specific field. Yeah, so here's an example of where it's accessing, here we go. So it's accessing the delay field of the configuration file, for example. So there are some nice topics in category theory about how to like narrow plugins so they only have access to specific fields or specific functions or specific state. That's outside the scope of this talk, but you can actually narrow plugins to focus in on only the things that matter to that specific plugin. But that would make this example a bit larger. So now we're going to name our plugins. So we want to know, when we run our program, what plugins we enabled. So again, it's almost the same as before, but now each plugin is a tuple, where the first field of the tuple is a list of strings, one string per plugin that's enabled. And the second field of the tuple is the plugin logic. So this characters tuple says, like, I am just one plugin, which is the characters plugin, and then here is the same logic as in the previous slide. Same thing for ticks, same thing for messages, and then when I combine all three, then this list of strings will contain the names of all three plugins. And the change I make to my driver function is after I've done acquiring resources and before the program begins, I just print all the plugins that were enabled in my program. So for example, if I run this, it will say, here are the plugins you enabled, characters, ticks, and messages, blah, blah, blah. And then if I were to disable one of my plugins like messages, then it would no longer show up in the initial plugin list. And the reason this works is because if our plugin logic here on the right is a monoid, and then this list of strings is a monoid, then the whole tuple is a monoid, which is why we can combine them all together, still using the mapend operator. Yes?
Why is it a list of strings as opposed to just a string?
So the question was, why is this a list of strings as opposed to a string? So if I were to just replace this list of strings with just a single string, then when I combined all three plugins, I would get a single string, which would be the concatenation of all three strings without any spaces in between the plugin names. So this actually splits them out into like separate names.
But is there a way to prevent multiple items being given in one?
So the question is, is there a way I can prevent duplicate names?
Yeah.
And yes, I can use a different monoid, which is a set of strings instead of a list of strings. So the set, if you combine two sets, then any duplicates will be removed. Yes.
Okay.
Was there another question?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
I just to piggyback on that, is there a way to bar one plugin from providing two names
for
the same plugin?
So the question was, is there a way to bar a plugin for providing two names instead of one? The answer is, if we just expose the original type, no. A plugin like characters could add as many names as it wanted. One way you could do that is you provide a helper function for building plugins, and that helper function only allows you to supply one name.
But at a type level, I'm saying.
No, not at the type level, because the whole point is that each plugin has the same type as the final composite result. So if the final composite result can have multiple plugin names, then each plugin should, because it's the same type, be able to supply multiple plugin names too. A plugin could provide no names. It could provide like the empty list too. Yes?
You could probably define a new instance type that contains a string and then defines the monoid map and
So the question was, he said he pointed out that you could provide a new type wrapper around strings that has its own monoid instance that combines strings in the correct way in order to avoid this issue. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, before we continue, so the next section I'm going to talk about composing things at the type level. Do people have any questions before I move on to them? In addition to the questions that were already asked. Okay. So there was actually an underlying pattern in all of our monoid instances, which I would love to point out, which is that, let's go back to our original monoid instance for the subroutines. So this monoid instance is really interesting in that none of the actual logic right here is actually specific to subroutines. So we use return, and we use Haskell's do notation. And if you're a little bit more familiar with Haskell, you'll know that these work for any type that implements a certain interface named monad. And I haven't talked about monads yet, and I'm not going to talk about them a lot, other than to point out they're just another interface like monoids, and any type that implements monad basically specifies what return does and what do notation does. So you can overload do notation in Haskell, and you can overload return in Haskell just by specifying an implementation of the monad interface. And so if that's true, then that means that I can replace IO with anything that implements the monad interface, and this code will still type check. So I can just start churning out monoid instances, one for every single monad that I can find. Practice, you may not want to do that, but you can do it. here's a cool example. So it actually turns out that our original monoid instance for functions it can be written this way, because functions implement the monad interface. The reason this works is because this syntax right here, a function from the type A to the type B, is actually syntax sugar for this prefix form right here. And then in Haskell standard libraries, there's something that says that a function of type A is a monad. So I can use return to build functions, and I can use do notation to combine functions. And this monoid instance for functions is identical in behavior to the one we wrote before. It just uses do notation and return instead. In fact, we can also do the exact same thing for tuples as well. So I can use return and do notation for tuples. And again, the reason this works is because in Haskell, this syntax right here, a tuple of type A and B, is syntactic sugar for this prefix form, saying the two tuple type constructor applied to the types A and B. And a tuple whose first type is A is a monad if and only if A is a monoid. And that's why I can use return and do notation to write the monoid instance for two tuples of A and B. And this instance is identical in behavior to the one we wrote before. We're just using return and do. So the underlying pattern here is that we could write this very general instance, although we don't want to for practical reasons, which basically says that if F implements this monad interface, meaning it implements return and do, and M implements the monoid interface, then any type of the shape FM is a monoid, where MD means to return the empty result, and when we combine two values of this type, we run the first one, run the second one, and then combine the results. And what's really cool is that this implementation is guaranteed to obey the monoid laws. I'm not going to show the proof for that, but it's true. So we don't need to actually do anything when we do any proof work to show that it satisfies the monoid laws. So this makes it easy for us to scale up monoid instances to more complex types.
Is there M instead of B?
These names bear, so the question was, should these be named MA and MB? These names right here bear no relation to these type letters up here. So.
And what I mean is when you extract A out of...
Oh, yeah, sorry, there's a type on the slide. So if this is named MA, then this should be MA right here instead of PA. And same thing for MB and PB. So yeah, the slide is a mistake. All right, and if you're even more familiar with Haskell, you know that we can actually generalize this just a little bit further. So it turns out there's an interface which is more general than the Monad interface called applicative. And when I say more general, I mean that there are more types that implement the applicative interface, because every type that implements the Monad interface has to also implement the applicative interface. But the converse is not true. Every type that implements applicative might not necessarily implement the Monad interface. And I'm not going to go into too much detail about the applicative interface other than to point out that every type that's an applicative provides two functions, one of which is called pure, which says that if f implements the applicative interface, then we can take any value of type a and then just wrap it in f. And it doesn't matter what f is, we can just wrap it. We just do this over and over again if we want to. And then lift a2 is a way of taking functions, taking binary functions on, like, for example, a binary function of two arguments, a and b, that returns a c. And we can lift them to work over values wrapped in f. So in other words, we can take a simple binary function and transform it into a more complex binary function. And what's unique about pure and lift a2 is that they have exactly the right shape to wrap mempty and mapend. So for example, if I wrap mempty and pure, now I can create an empty value of type f of m. And if I wrap mapend and lift a2, now I have a way to combine two f of m values into a new value of type f of m. And so I can then write this very general instance which says that to create the empty value of type f of m is just pure mempty. And then mapend is just lift a2 mapend. So it's very abstract and high level, but it works and it satisfies all the Monad laws. And it does the right thing. And we can just keep repeating this process over and over and over again. So let's say I have this really complex type of this shape right here. So it's like we have several applicatives, f1, f2, f3, dot, 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 f of n, wrapping some monoid named m. And I want to create an empty value of that type. Well, I can just write pure, 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 dot, 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 pure, empty. And then that's the empty value of that large type. And same thing, if I want to combine two values of this large type, I can just say lift a2, lift a2, lift a2, lift a2, dot, 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 lift a2, map end. And that is exactly the right type to combine two values of this shape. In fact, we already saw an example of that in our second section. So let's look at our type of plugin, right? So we can think of our plugin as a tuple of string labels as a function for configuration to manage transaction events. So if I want to write a monoid instance for plugin, I can just say the empty plugin is just pure, 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 empty, and I'm done. I want to say, I will combine two plugins, I can just say lift a2, lift a2, lift a2, map end, those two plugins, and I'm done. And it satisfies all the Monad laws. And you can think of this sort of like, again, this is sort of like a Unix pipeline, except it's at the type level instead of at the value level. So each of these applicative types, like f1, f2, f3, these are each type level features that do one thing and do it well. And we want a way to connect these together using some sort of a universal interface. In Unix, the universal interface is streams of text. At this type level, the universal interface is going to be monoids. Every applicative takes some monoid as an input and produces a new, more complex monoid as an output that it can feed to the next applicative. And then we can mix and match these applicatives at the type level the same way we mix and match MUX commands to develop new, complex functionality. And so, to make the correspondence to Unix pipelines exact, so this is all legal Haskell code. So all I'm going to do is define a type level composition operator using a capital O. You can use backticks to make an infix type level function. And this basically says, if we compose at the applicative f with the applicative g, it's sort of like function composition except at the type level. That's equivalent to the type constructor f applied to constructor g applied to the type a. This reads almost just like the definition of function composition on our very first slide. And it says if f is an applicative and g is an applicative, then we can show that f composed with g is an applicative. This is guaranteed to work. And then we can also provide a monoid instance for this this type level composition type. And then, there's also, if we have a type level composition, we should have a type level identity. And that is called the identity functor. And this is why it's called the identity functor, because it's the identity of type level composition.
Question?
Yes.
I saw that you did deriving functor.
Yes.
How do you get that?
Oh, so the question was, he noticed that I was using this derived functor language extension. This is an extension provided by GHC. Like, the way you get this extension is you just add that line to your program, and for a large number of types, then you can just write try any functor and you're done, and GHC will produce a correct functor instance.
Are there any constraints under which this operates?
So the question was, are there any constraints for where this works? Yes, you can. I don't know off the top of my head where the rules are, but if this doesn't work, the compiler will yell at you and say, I can't derive a functor instance for this type. So just throw stuff at the wall until it works. That's the way you work with
GHC. I guess the question is, how do you make it work, like, if it complains?
Generally, a good rule is that, like, types this will work on are sums, so like sort of like either, and products, like tuple, that's it will derive automatically using this functor type. And things, I think, underneath a function, if it's in the positive position of a function, I think it will also work. And you just, if you can combine like positive position of a function, sums, and products in various ways, it'll keep continuing to work to derive functor.
Are you deriving functors so that, why are you deriving functor?
I was too lazy to write the functor instance. That's the only reason. I could have handwritten the functor instance for this type right here, but I just didn't want to.
But why did you need PID? Why did you need the instance?
Oh, so the question was, why did I even provide a functor instance? So in Haskell, type classes can, so remember how a type class like monoid can provide constraints. We can say things like a and b, a tuple of a and b is a monoid, if and only if a is a monoid and b is a monoid. Well, we can also do that to enforce what we call subclass, superclass relationships in Haskell. So if you go to the applicative class in Haskell, you see something that says that if f is an applicative, then it also has to be a functor. So you cannot provide an applicative instance unless you also provided a functor instance. And the same thing for the monad interface. It says that you can't define a monad unless you also define an applicative instance for the same type.
So isn't there a derived applicative thing?
No, unfortunately there is not a way to automatically derive applicative, mainly because I don't think for functor, if there's an implementation, it's guaranteed to be unique. Whereas that's not necessarily true for applicative, which is why the compiler cannot automatically derive applicative for you. Same reason why it can't derive monoid. Like, for many types, there's not a unique implementation of monoid, but for functor, there is. It's guaranteed to be unique, and there's, I think somebody proved it. It's a cool proof.
The paper that talks about how functor, et cetera, and monoid and such can get derived. There's actually some extensions to that research that can apply it to applicative and monad for certain data types. Mm-hmm. And it's actually like it's a surprisingly expansive set of data types in practice.
So to repeat for the benefit of the recording, somebody pointed out that there's a paper showing that for a subset of types, you can't automatically derive applicative and monoid instances, and you said monad too, I think.
Yeah.
And then it's actually a surprisingly large number of types where there's a unique solution for that. If that's the case, then I would really love such a GHC extension to do that, because that would make my life easier.
It's in shapeless now.
So. Oh, really? That's cool. Okay. So again, for the benefit of the recording, they pointed out that this is in shapeless in order the ability to derive applicative monad and monoid for many types. So again, just like back at the beginning, we said that function compositions should obey certain laws, and type-level compositions should also obey certain laws. So if we compose the identity functor with any other applicative type f, it should be isomorphic to f. Isomorphic means that they're not exactly the same, but they're interchangeable. You can reversibly convert between the two. And maybe Alejandro's talk in Category 3 might cover isomorphisms. I don't know if it will or not. But that's another interesting topic from Category Theory, is the notion of isomorphism. And the same thing is that this type-level composition operator is associative up to isomorphism. And again, it's just like the left identity, right identity for and the associativity for ordinary function composition.
The equality is a different...
Yes, this is not true equality. Okay. So these are not... If it were true equality, then these would be the same type, which they're not. These are not the same types. This means that I could write a function to convert from this type constructor to this... I can write a natural transformation from this type constructor to this type constructor, and I can write a natural transformation from this type constructor to this type constructor such that they are inverses of each other. So that's what this isomorphism sign means in this context. So using this type of composition, I could instead just write my plugin type as compose a tuple of strings composed with a function of configurations, composed with the man duplicative, then apply that to the transaction monoid, and I'm done. And it's automatically applicative, automatically a monoid, and which is really cool. So I'm actually composing these at the type level. And again, each one of these things is just doing one thing and doing it well. This is just adding labels. This is just throwing in configurations. This is just doing resource management. And I can turn on and off these extensions just by adding or removing things from my type level composition pipeline.
When would you use what? Because you can do this at type level like
yeah.
this or the way you did it before.
Yeah. I mean, personally,
is it a matter of readability or?
So the question is, which would you recommend or prefer? And I would usually recommend doing something like I did on this slide. This is typically what I would do if I were doing it in my own code base as opposed to the type level composition. This is mainly just to show that this is more useful for mentally structuring how you view a type. So if you can think of a type as, oh, this is just this composed with that, then you can immediately understand what the type is doing. As opposed to if it's just like a bunch of non-modular, non-decoupled spaghetti that's like, I like things to be able to be decomposed into smaller things. I think that just helps the reasoning process. And also it's easier to reason that each individual component is correct if it's only doing one thing. Whereas if they're all fused together, then you can't as easily reason about their individual correctness. So in the beginning, we just began from simple composable functions. The composition operator was dot, and then id was id, and the composable units were pure functions. And then we generalized that to composable values using monoids. So the composition operator was the operator, the binary, the diamond bracket operator. And the identity was empty, and the composable units were the monoid values. And then you can generalize it to the type level where the composition operator is O, infix, and then the identity was the identity functor, and the composable units are applicative type constructors. And so this is just to give you an idea that abstractions from category theory are really useful when you want to decompose programs into smaller and simpler composable building blocks. And that is, I believe, the number one motivation for learning category theory is just learning to decompose your program that way. And if you would like to find these slides later on after this talk, you can find them. I have a GitHub repository called Slides, and there's a LambdaConf category subdirectory of that repository. And if you have any questions, feel free to tweet at me or email me afterwards.
Can you post that link to Slack?
Yes, absolutely. I can post the link. Any other questions? Oh, no. All right, thank you very much.